We have a crew out in the parking lot building the ark, so that if you would like to get back to your car after the service, we'll be glad to help you get there. But we have gathered, and I thank you for coming as we come to gather in the name of the Lord to enjoy Him speaking to us. That's what we do every time we gather in His name corporately. The Lord is speaking to us, and the Holy Spirit is in our midst, and the Holy Spirit is working in your heart. He desires for you to hear the Lord speak to you. He desires for the Lord to open up your eyes to see how He requires you to live in this present day and in this kind of setting that we're living in our culture and in our time. And we've been looking through about what kind of church do we need to be? What kind of vision do we have for the future? And we've been sharing that with you. And if you're visiting today, or if you haven't been here for a few weeks, we have this card that we'd love for you to take at the back of the table in the lobby. And take this home with you, because in it, it's going to tell you our vision statement and also what matters most to us about our values that we believe that are important for us going forward. So we've been walking through what that would look like and what that means. And we've also, last week, began to tell you about a way that we want to impact our city, even during this time. So I'm going to take a few seconds to tell you about what that is. We're asking every one of the members of Cornerstone to consider over the next 4 weeks, by the end of October, to consider offering $50 from each individual. We then want to take that and immediately go and serve our community through the ministries that we support. And we'll be sharing those stories next week and the following weeks to tell you about how that can be used. We've asked them to consider ways that we could help them in a way that they needed money but may not have been able to have it. And they would tell us ways that we could serve them and help them have an impact on our community. So that $50, I know, may be a sacrifice for some of you. We know that it's something that we're asking of you to maybe consider not going to lunch one day or not going to the movies or that sort of thing, and instead that you would be able to offer that here, and then we'd be able to see how the Lord would use it for impacting His city immediately. So putting into practice what we're trying to proclaim as a church. There's a little blurb in your bulletin that tells you more about that. But our goal would be, we would say that there's over 500 in membership, and we were saying, let's see if we can have 400 of us be able to give that and see that impact. And we will share and tell you the stories about what has happened and how the Lord has used that money over this time. That's all I'm going to say about that, because I don't want money to always be the issue. But we want to talk about how the Lord has richly blessed us and how the Lord has blessed us as a congregation to be now in this setting to enjoy the unity that the Lord has brought us together with. And today, we're going to look at our third core value, which is called humble service. We began talking about being gospel-focused, being gospel-centered, because we know that that is at the heart of all that we do and say at Cornerstone. That the gospel message and what Jesus Christ means to us is the most important thing that we can tell you. So if you're visiting today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, or you're trying to make sense about what does the Christian faith say to me and how should I live, we want you to understand that Jesus is to be at the center of all that you do and all that you believe. That's what those that have gathered and said they're members of Cornerstone, they've said that they would follow Jesus because of what He has done for them. For He has done for us what we could never do for ourselves. And that becomes foundational for everything that we are as a church. We have to start there and understand that what Jesus accomplished on our behalf, when He took our sin and He took our place on the cross, He then has created a new creature in us, a new church, a new way of living. And this is how the gospel starts to impact our daily life and how vital it is for us to comprehend and to grasp the depth of God's love for us, that He would send Jesus Christ to do what we could not do for ourselves. And if we were to ponder and to meditate and to think about what that means, it would change everything about us. And we began to see that it would change the way we would look at people, that we would become a people who love people because of what Jesus has done. He's displayed His love for mankind in offering Himself. So if we were going to be a follower of His, certainly it's going to be seen in how we love one another because of what he has done. He first loved us, so now we are a people who can love God and love people and serve others and serve our city and beyond. That's what we want you to memorize. That's what we hope that you would grasp and be able to fully comprehend. So when you have conversations with people at your workplace or in your neighborhood or in the grocery store, you're able to say, this is what Cornerstone is all about. And we hope you'll take that to heart, to put those words in your mouth, to be able to say and to comprehend what it means to be a part of Cornerstone. We need to be a people who love God so deeply that we cherish what he has done and accomplished for us, that we marvel at his greatness and we are amazed by his love toward us. And because of that, then it automatically shows itself in the way that we relate to one another and to relate to the least and the lost in our community. We become a people who love people. And then this morning, we're going to look at this whole idea of humble service. The understanding of what the Lord does in our life, the gospel destroys this idea that we can try harder in life and all we have to do is just go do it or pick up a self-help book and we can improve ourselves. The gospel is going to remind us that that's not possible without Jesus Christ entering into our life. And the gospel is then going to show us a new way to live our life, and it's going to be through humble service. We're going to see that Jesus Christ has acted that way on our behalf. In all that he did, he was a humble servant, and people thought he would come as a king in all of his glory and splendor. That fanfare would have been there, but instead he comes and he rides into Jerusalem on a donkey, and people had placed their coats down as he would ride through the city, and they said, "Blessed is this one who has come in the name of the Lord." And they waved palm branches as he walked through the city. And he came in such a humble way. He came as a baby into this world. Far different than all the people and even the Israelites had expected. And this is why they rejected him, because they didn't think he fit what they expected in this Messiah. And instead, he was showing the world how his people would become humble people of service. Now, humility is something we see lacking in our culture. We cherish the proud. We actually put that in fanfare. We are going to watch some television this afternoon, maybe some of the football games and some of the activities that are there, and we're going to see a lot of pride on the field. We're going to see people beating their chests and saying, "Look at me," as they celebrate the touchdowns or the different things that are there. We see it in our workplace when somebody's proud of what they've been able to accomplish and they're going to tell everybody about it. We know what pride looks like, don't we? But humility is what we all long for and desire to see have happen. We need to understand that God's grace is going to enable us to be a humble people, to serve as our Savior served us. I played on a number of sports teams, and I have coached a lot of players. And one of the hardest things you had to do was to teach some of the kids to be humble. And I was on the playing field and had the same struggle. When I would be able to do some of the accomplishments that I was there, it was very easy for the pride to well up in me and be proudful of what the Lord had given to me. And humility becomes the model for us to understand. Now, I've been doing a lot of reading in management and leadership, and one of my favorite writers is Patrick Lencioni. And he wrote a book called The Ideal Team Player. And in that book, he began to see, as he studied how different companies operate and how they function, what is the ideal person that you want to have on your team, in your environment and in your setting? What is it that we desire to have? And he began to see that there were some common elements over and over again. And he said that there's three things that they look for. And it changed the whole way he ran his company. It changed the whole way he began to hire people. He changed the whole way that they evaluated the staff that were there. He said these three things need to be present in any person that's going to be an ideal team member. He said they need to be hungry. They need to be people that are able to go and be excited about what they're doing. They need to be humble. They need to understand that they need to see others around them greater than themselves. And then the third said, you need to be smart. He wasn't talking about IQ. He was talking about people skills, that you're smart with people. And he said, these are the three things that he would then say to any organization as he's invited to come in and speak to different companies, that you need to have people that are humble, you need to have people that are hungry, and you need to have people that are people smart. And he said that humility was at the core. And probably the most missing ingredient in the workplace was humility. And he wrote this, great team players lack excessive ego or concerns about status. They are quick to point out the contributions of others and slow to seek attention for their own. They share credit, emphasize team over self, and they define success collectively rather than individually. It's no great surprise then that humility is the single greatest and most indispensable attribute of being a team player. Now, I've heard Patrick Lencioni speak in public many times that I've gone to some conferences there. I believe he's a believer. And I believe that that has shaped his, and even in the end of this book, he's going to talk about Jesus Christ being a model of humility for an organization. And humility is something that we need to understand, needs to be part of who we are, part of our DNA, that if pride is what people witness in us when they gather with us and maybe walk in the middle of us or sit here on Sunday morning in our midst, if that becomes what they see, then it's not that attractive. But when you see the humility of Jesus Christ and the gospel having the effect in changing the way we look and serve one another, that changes everything about us, and it changes everything about this church. So this is why it's one of our core values, that we believe it's important for us to emphasize that this is who we are. We are to be a humble people because we have a humble Savior. And Lencioni said the ideal thing that would help him as a company would be trying to find those kind of people that would be there. And he's looking at it from a secular standpoint about how important it is in business, but how much importance is there in regard to how the church is to look and how the church is to be received? Oh, the gospel is going to remind us how indispensable humility is in following Jesus Christ. It's so simple to look at his life and to see what kind of Savior we have, to understand how he came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, as Pete mentioned in Mark chapter 10. And the passages of Scripture that tell us over and over again, the suffering servant in Isaiah 53, showing that he would take on our sin on our behalf. He would be that kind of Savior that would come in a humble way and in a humble means. And this is what God wanted you to see, that this is the kind of kingdom he was producing. This is the kind of people, and this is the kind of church he wants for our world. So if you have your Bibles, I'd love for you to turn to Luke chapter 22. This is one of the many passages that talks about the squabbles and the fights that were going on, even among the followers of Jesus. The closest one, this is about the disciples who didn't fully grasp what the gospel meant for them. And here's the story of what went on. Hear the word of the Lord for this morning. A dispute also arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. They began to have this argument of who was the greatest of all. Now they had just heard, Jesus is in the upper room, this is his final week, and he's been celebrating the Passover meal. And he had just told them that one of them was going to betray him. And immediately the result was, well, which one of us is not going to do that? We're the best ones, so let's figure out who's the best of them all. It was one of those experiences, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the greatest of them all? And that's what we see and hear in our culture all the time, and it was happening in the life of the disciples. And he said to them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Not so with my church. Not so with my followers who will say that they walk in my footsteps. That's not the way we will live. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is the greater, one who reclines at a table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. And that is how Jesus responded to his own disciples that had been walking with him for 3 years. And it was about the end of his time with them. And he speaks to them and reminds them, I stand before you as someone who serves. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the model of what Jesus Christ means for us. For he came into this world as a child, as a baby. He came in all humility. And humble service marked everything that he did as he cared for the least and the lost, as he cared for those who needed him most, and how he would offer up his life for us because we couldn't do anything to rescue ourselves. But instead, he said, move out of the way. I have come. And all you who are weak and weary, come and I will give you rest. And in his life that he lived, and in his death that he died, and in his resurrection where he burst out of the grave, he showed to us the type of people that we are to be. So, Father, we pray that you would enable us to comprehend and to grasp what it means to be humble and what it means to be a servant. And may the gospel penetrate into our hearts to change the very way we look and the way we live and the way we speak, for we know that that is your design for us. And we know that that gospel is at work in us, and we pray by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would continue to shape us and to mold us into the likeness of Jesus Christ. For your glory we pray. Amen. So as we sit and think about this issue, there was a problem for the people that were followers of Jesus. They struggled with this idea of being proud, and they had a lack of humility. This wasn't the first time. You can read some of the other gospel accounts. Even one of the mothers of two brothers came to Jesus and began to say to him, "Will you give my sons the seat of prominence in your kingdom?" And he said to her, "You do not know what you're asking." And the disciples had this repeating kind of idea. Who's the greatest? Mirror, mirror on the wall, tell us who's the greatest of us all. And they lined up and hoped that it was them. And that's the type of environment that Jesus is speaking to them, to chide them, to bring them back to an understanding of what he was doing and what he displayed before their very life. And they didn't get it. And there were multiple times that they were living this way, squabbling and fighting because pride was rooted in their heart. And Jesus had to speak into their life and remind them that that was contrary living according to the gospel. So let me set the conflict in its setting here for a moment. They're in the Passover celebration. They're in an upper room. Normally, the families would gather together and they would be celebrating the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Celebrating what happened in the Old Testament. So if you're not familiar with what the Passover means, I want to tell you a little bit about what that event was. It was one of the most important events in Israel's history and is still true today for any Jewish person. It is the most celebrated part of their calendar. This idea of the Passover, and what they remembered was what happened in that day in the time of Moses. And Moses was the leader of the Israelites, and God had told them that they needed to put blood over the doors of their doorposts and of their homes, so that the angel of the Lord would pass over and they would be covered by the blood that would be on the doorposts. So they were to take a lamb. And in this meal that they were having, it was a reminder of the wine and the bread, part of their experience and their difficulty of going through the wilderness, of following God in the midst of a world that lives against God. And the Lord rained down bread out of heaven called manna. And this bread was a daily provision for them, but it was a description of the affliction that they were going through. And then the wine that was part of that meal was to remind them of the covering that they needed. And then the center of the meal was the Passover lamb. And this beautiful lamb would be chosen. And this lamb would be offered up for every family as they would gather there. And the lamb was to be the reminder that something had to pay for the sin and their transgression. And this Passover meal was now being celebrated at the time of Jesus being in Jerusalem and his disciples. They've gathered in the upper room. They're not with their family, but now they're gathered as the church, as the body of Christ together. And Jesus begins to unfold to them what it means with this Passover meal. And he begins to tell them for the very first time that he's the fulfillment of the Passover meal. Of the Old Testament, all of these celebrations year after year after year that they would celebrate the Passover, Jesus was telling them that he is the center of the Passover festival. Because the gospel would tell us, one of the gospels said this, Jesus is the Passover lamb. And that is his title in the New Testament. And Jesus is the one that this whole festival was reminding them of, that he would offer his life. And Jesus is saying to them, listen, you're worried about your status and your wealth and your power and your prestige. You're more worried about you having first place. He said, I have come to show you that that's not the way to live and to find success and meaning in life. If you truly want to grasp it, he said, follow after me and understand that I gave my all for you. And Jesus becomes the model of our Lord's Supper. And he institutes that for the church, for the future, to remind them that this one is coming back again. And he said in their presence, he said, I will never taste of this again until I come again in my glory. So those disciples sitting in his presence knew that there was a future hope for us. And this table would be a reminder of the humbleness of our Savior and of our Creator God, who would do everything necessary to make us right with him again. He would go to the greatest extent to show his love for you and me. And this is the Savior we follow. And he said, I want you to be a people like this in a watching world. And when you see people in need, I don't want you to pass over them. I don't want you to walk around them. I don't want you to ignore them. I want you to see them. And I want you to respond to them. I want you to help them, because that's why I've placed you here. And that's why I've built my church, to be a body that would be caring for people around them, promoting Jesus Christ in the way that we treat others. Evidence that Jesus is in us, because he said, you will know my disciples by their love for one another. And this is the type of people that the church needs to be. In our culture, our world needs to see the beauty of God's church, of a caring body, because so many arenas of life where there is not much humility, and everyone struggling for their own advantage, everyone taking opportunity for themselves. That's what our world sees day after day. And we're even going to see it in a football game when there are players and there to be a team. Instead, we're going to see players act as individuals instead of acting like a team. And Jesus knew that that was our struggle. He knew that that was one of our problems, is that pride wells up in our heart. So he presents himself and shows you how to walk in a way that is worthy of the calling that the Lord has given to us. So he unfolds this idea that Jesus is that Passover lamb, and he's showing them of how much he desires for them to live according to what he did. He would display it to them in his offering up of his life. And he gave them another example where he would get down at that meal and he took a little basin and a towel, and he began to wash his disciples' feet to show them and to display to them that this is how the Savior looks at one another and at people, and how he desires for you and me to live. He desires for us to serve, to serve, because that is how the Lord came into this world. And he said this: the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors, but not so with you. He wanted to tell them, look, that's the way the Gentiles live, but not my kingdom, not my people. When they sit and see the privilege and see the opportunity, and he's describing that in the way that they do, the benefactors were the people that were receiving all of these great blessings because they were people of stature. And so Jesus is saying, that's not what we're going to be doing in the kingdom of God that's visible on this earth. I want you to see that the first will be the last. I want you to understand that it's going to be the servant instead of the proud. It's going to be the humble that he invites into the kingdom of God. And so he says, but not so with you. The gospel makes sure that we are a humble people, because we begin to see how it plays out for us, that Jesus in all of his actions served us and loved us and accomplished this on our behalf. He did not consider the greatness that he had something to hold on to. Instead, he came and humbled himself in this world and took on flesh, so he became just like us. And so Paul is going to tell that to the Philippians, and he's going to tell them in that beautiful passage of Scripture. He says this: do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Have this mind among yourself, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped. But he emptied himself. He humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. And Paul says that to the Philippians, and he says it to you and me this morning to remind us that this is our Savior and this is our Lord. And he calls us to look like him in this world. So Jesus said this and to his disciples, rather, let the greatest among you become the youngest. So in that day and in that economy, the older you got, the more prestige and status you had, and the younger served the older. And that was the way that it would go. That was the customs of its day. And so Jesus is saying, okay, let's think about this for a moment. Let the greatest among you become as the youngest. He's saying, I want you to reverse what's happening in your culture. I want you to change the way that everybody else looks at it. I want you to see that is not the way you should live. You should live in this way. Let the greatest become its youngest, and the leader as one who serves. Servant leadership becomes the model for the church. It should be what our elders, our trustees, and our deacons look like. It should be what you look like to people that don't know the church and don't know Christ, that you display it in the way that you humbly serve one another and serve our world. For who is the greater, the one who reclines at the table or the one who serves? So he's talking about what was happening at the table of the Passover meal. The ones reclining had the important place in that setting. And so Jesus said this: for who is greater, the one who reclines at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? He admits that that's the place of prestige, that's a place of power, that's a place of status. But I am among you as the one who serves. And he flips it upside down and begins to say, look, I am here reclining at the table, but my primary role is to serve. And so Mark writes this beautiful passage of Scripture. Jesus did not come into this world to be served. He came into this world to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. That's the type of Lord we serve. And the ancient world saw humility as a weakness. They saw it as something that would not be beneficial. And Jesus turns their whole understanding upside down. It's exactly what he was doing in the days of his disciples. By the end of the book of Acts, I've told you over and over again, at the end they turned the world upside down because the gospel changed the way they lived, it changed the way they served, it changed the way they loved people. And because of that, it turned the whole world upside down because they lived according to the ways that Jesus commanded them to live. The gospel seeped into their heart and changed Peter and James and John, even those that were fighting to determine who's the greatest of them all, and it changed their life, and they began to grasp it, and they began to live it, and each and every one of those disciples came to the conclusion of their life as a martyr for Jesus Christ, humbly serving the people around them, and the church flourished and expanded in great ways. Andrew Murray wrote a wonderful little booklet called Humility, and he said this: without humility, there can be no true dwelling in God's presence or enjoying his favor and the power of his Spirit. Without humility, there's no faith, no love, no joy, nor strength demonstrated in our lives. Humility is the only soil in which grace takes root. The lack of humility is the reasonable explanation for every defect and failure in the Christian life. Humility is not so much a blessing or attribute along with others. It is the root of it all. It alone takes the right attitude before God and allows Him to sanctify us. A beautiful definition of what humility means for the church. Because we have a Savior who would get down on the ground and take a towel and a basin and ask for his disciples' feet that were dirty and messed up. And even Peter said, not mine, Lord. If you're going to do mine, wash all of me because I'm so filthy. Just as Peter would often do, speaking before he has heard or speaking before he has learned. And so often we're like that as well. But we have a Savior who took a towel and a basin before he mounted the cross. And then we have a Savior who took a cross before he would wear a crown. That changes everything about us and changes the way we will live. And this is why humble service is one of the values that matter most to us as a congregation at Cornerstone. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your love that would be so displayed before us that we grasp how marvelous and how wonderful your love is toward us. We pray that in the work that you do and in our lives through the power of your Holy Spirit and the hearing of your preached word, that you would continue to mold us and shape us into Christ followers that display the humble service that you require of us. Oh Lord, we thank you. And we ask for your power to be upon us as we continue to be a church that strives to go forward in our future, to be a church that represents you in this world. May we be marked by a people that are gospel-centered and people-focused, and humble service becomes the model of what we do, all for your glory's sake and not our own. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.